I welcome the distinguished minds here, as well as I welcome the distinguished participants and minds there, because the last session very well demonstrated that it was not only the generals and the experts who were speaking extremely coherent and giving incisive insights, it was also the audience. So welcome you all. Coming straight to the point and telling you a little about the speakers as I see them. I have known Madhuji for a long time and Nitin for some while primarily through his tweets. And I have noticed in both the speakers there is a similarity. When they write, it is as if a small carpet, but very richly embroidered. There is a lot of content in a few words they pack. So let me share that with both of you that we really appreciate that, and which is what we will try. This session will also go in this, this session also goes in a similar way, because they have a lot to say and there are a lot of points to ask them. Coming straight to the discussion, Madhuji, in the last 3 to 4 years, has the social discourse become more sulfurous, or it is fumigation, you think, which was required?
हाँ दे दो तो अच्छा है कहीं सिद्धार्थ हो गया और किसी को चोट वोट लग गई तो एनीवे यू नो आई एम वन ऑफ दोज हु थिंक दिस होल नैरेटिव अबाउट ग्रोइंग इनटॉलरेंस सल्फरस डिस्कोर्स इज अ बिट ओवरस्टेटेड आई थिंक द बिग डिफरेंस एंड अ वेरी वेलकम चेंज हैज बीन द अराइवल ऑफ सोशल मीडिया. I consider it one of the biggest revolutions in contemporary history, because it has bridged the gap between the elite and the very ordinary. On social media, you're all equal. Earlier, it's a very small segment of the intellectual elite who had access to newspaper, writing columns, or being interviewed on TV, or being invited to audiences like this. The rest of the people were totally voiceless. We were only passive recipients. Ordinary people were passive recipients. I belong to both the worlds, so. And I say both the worlds, meaning once upon a time I was really sought after by newspapers and TV, etc. But the moment I wrote this cursed book on Modi, my God, I became a persona non grata. No publisher wanted my book. I couldn't get a place to get it released. My colleagues stopped talking to me. My friends disowned me. I mean, total paria. And if it weren't for social media, I would have felt choked. I really think that, and I personally enjoy even the sulfurous feedback I get. Because it holds a mirror to you. It tells you what's your real worth. Are you able to engage with a diverse set of people, all of who are not dying to admire you, but they are judging you on merit? Are you able to deal with criticism? Are you able to deal with diversity of views, diversity in ways of expressing themselves? It makes you emotionally and intellectually so versatile. And I find it ridiculous that people are upset and they call it growing intolerance, growing this, that, and just because somebody expresses a view which is contrary to mine or tells me you're being a fool, doesn't mean the person is intolerant. They're telling me, please rethink. Some could be malice, but then you know how to deal with malice. It's only malice. In fact, Twitter or social media gives you the option to just block them. Real life, we don't have that option. So I personally celebrate the diversity of voices that are available, where an ordinary citizen can talk back to the prime minister, to the highest political office in this country, to the big corporate honchos, and hold a mirror to them. We should celebrate it. This is real democracy. what we had was a very tame and a very, very limiting and limited media. And so for me, it's freedom. I love it.
So very well put. And this brings us to a definition of this point of view. Philosophers have defined this point of view as the romantic point of view. There is another point of view which is called the classic point of view. The classic point of view should say you should tell your truth well. The romantic point of view says that you should tell your truth brazenly and openly. Now, I would like to bring in Nitin here. What is it that you say, Nitin, on this point which Madhuji has said?
I'll give you an electrical engineer's point of view. That's what I am. Let me just start. See, I've been online, I think the first time I sent an email was in 1993. So, you know, VT100 terminals and text, green text running through your thing. And we had forms of online conversations for a long time. And up until 2016, I would think, I still thought thought that it's uniformly a power for greater access to internet, social media is uniformly a good thing, because Madhuji said, it brings a huge number of voices into the conversation. These were the voices were underrepresented because they were not powerful, maybe they belonged to a particular ideological persuasion which was considered non grata, and they were shunned by if you have the power to decide who comes to this and you don't invite me, I'm just out of the conversation, right? So I think the internet, at least from the time it's come into consumer hands for the last 20, 25 years, has done that. Where I think we've got a trouble with this, and now I've become deeply worried for the future of democracy, is exactly the same thing, the other side of this coin. Let me just explain. There are two aspects to this. One is, a democracy is only as good as the quality of public discourse. Right? We were just discussing this. And that's why, to praise you because you've invited me and given me lunch, that's why I think Blue Circle makes a very important difference, because it raises the level of public discourse. But very few online platforms raise the level of discourse. They broaden the level of discourse. They make it very superficial, but they don't deepen the level of discourse, nor do they raise the standards of discourse, right? So that's one. So your public discourse uniformly has fallen over the last 10 years, I would say, right? The second is a little more insidious. The idea of democracy, liberal democracy, is based on an enlightenment value that an individual is a rational person, and as a rational person can weigh the pros and the cons of any decision and arrive at a decision which is self-optimizing. So each person decides on the same issue in a different way according to his or her own lights. Now, behavioral research and empirical evidence on democracy has proven that this is not true. People don't make decisions based on individuals deciding what's the trade-offs. Humans make decisions based on social proof. So I believe that this water is good to drink because you think so and she thinks so and the people in this room think so, and therefore I think this is great water to drink, right? I might decide to vote for a certain person, I might have a certain political opinion, decide to go to a particular college. All of this depends not on an objective evaluation made by an individual, but by social proof. Now, what's happened with the social media is that there are a lot of echo chambers, and echo chambers create their own version of truth. So when they talk about post-fact, post-truth, fake news and all that, it's not that there is a contestation on an objective reality, right? What's happening is people have their own version of the truth, large numbers of people believe in their own version of the truth, and because a lot of people believe in that version of the truth, a lot more people believe in that version of the truth. Now, that's okay if you're talking about art and culture and all that, but if you're talking about monetary policy or whom to vote, whether a person is guilty of a crime or not. These are places where you need to have an objective evaluation, and that is suffering. Okay?